We're back with our politics lead, and 7 days into the government shutdown, President Trump is now threatening to close down the entire southern border if he doesn't get funding for a border wall. Joining me now is outgoing Democratic Senator Joe Donnelly of Indiana. Senator, thank you so much for coming on with me.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We are in day seven of this partial shutdown. What do you think the end game is here?
Well, we voted, before Christmas in an agreement with the administration on a $1.3 billion number. And the president changed his mind the next day. And so the biggest problem is we need to find out, when the president will say, we'll take yes for an answer has been the problem. And so the end game here, it's going to eventually get to a point where the House will be having Nancy Pelosi as speaker, and they'll send over a $1.3 billion bill, I imagine, something like that. Look, there's a way that we can do this, but the president is not going to get his border wall, not with the change that's coming. And so, there are opportunities here, but that's not going to be part of it. The president can talk about changes around the edges as an improvement, as a win, as getting him closer to a border wall. But I think that's the discussion that's coming.
That's interesting, because you are somebody who looked for areas of a compromise, but you think that this is just not an area where Democrats should or would compromise. He should just forget about the wall.
Well, I don't think you're going to find that the funding is going to be there for the wall. You know, there are things that can be done where there's additional funding for drug interdictions, for instance. We lost over 70,000 Americans this past year to drug overdoses. Mm-hmm. Much of it is coming across the border from Mexico. We know that Southern Command and Northern Command, I've served on the Armed Services Committee, are desperately short of funds to stop the drugs coming in. And so maybe there could be an additional plus up to work on stopping those drugs from coming in, on working at the border crossings where those drugs are coming in. Mm-hmm. But there won't be funding for the wall.
Very interesting. So you are serving in your last few days of Congress right now. So is Missouri Senator Claire McCaskill, who, like you, was defeated in November. She sat down with CNN's Manu Raju to talk about Republicans you serve with and what they really think about the president. Take a listen.
Now, they'll tell you, if it's just the two of you, the guy's nuts. He doesn't have a grasp of the issues. He's making brash decisions. He's not listening to the people who know the subject matter. But in public, if they go after him, they know they get a primary. And they know that's tough.
Senator, have you heard similar things from your GOP colleagues?
Well, we know they're very, very concerned about the primary situation. And look, in the work we do, everything is based on your word, and your word is your bond. And like early last year or this year, we put together an agreement to do the border wall, as well as DACA funding. 10 Democrats, 10 Republicans. It was a team effort. The president said, if you do this, I'll get this. I'll move it forward. We all kind of looked at each other, and we knew that we could get this done. We'll get it to that point. And it may well sink at the White House that night, because having the word, yeah, I'm going to stand by this and do it, doesn't always work with this president. That what it is today is very different tomorrow, and all my colleagues know that.
But on the notion that Republicans, in the cloakroom, on the floor, are saying to you and your fellow Democrats that kind of thing, or as Senator McCaskill said, they think he's nuts or whatever, choose your adjective. Are you hearing that as well?
Well, what I'm hearing is that they're really concerned about the judgment, that we know as a Senate how to get out of this process, but we don't know how we ever get an agreement out of the White House, for instance, on the wall. There's paths there that we have all talked about and that can get done, but the problem is it then gets to the point where there's an agreement one day. Then the next day, they listen to Rush Limbaugh, and everything changes. And so that's the problem, is there's no consistency from day to day.
I want to ask you about your party, about the Democratic Party. You lost in Indiana in November. McCaskill, we just talked about, lost in Missouri. Heidi Heitkamp lost in North Dakota. The Democratic Party was already receding to the coasts, even more so now. So can the Democratic Party, your party, be viable without appealing to the interior of the country where you live and where you represent?
Boy, I don't know how you do that. I mean, I was fortunate enough, I got more votes in this midterm than any Democrat in Indiana in modern history. But it wasn't quite enough because the president came three times in about the last week, six times in about the last month and a half, and said, this is about him. And he said, if you don't vote, basically, you're betraying me. And we have not made enough of a connection. I work like a dog nonstop to make that connection. But that the people of my state understand that culturally, we want to make sure you succeed, that we're going to fight to make sure that, for instance, on student loans, we'll keep the interest rate at the same rate as a housing loan. But when you talk Medicare for all, like I heard on the panel earlier, you start losing the people in my state. When we start talking about, hey, we're going to work together with the insurance companies to lower premiums, that's what connects. And so, you know, the talk on the coasts just doesn't get it done in the middle. And Dana, this presidential election that's coming up, you know, what's going to happen on the coast is already baked in the cake. This is going to be won in Pennsylvania and Ohio and Michigan and Wisconsin and North Carolina and Florida and Arizona and Iowa. And that's where the meat and potatoes is going to be. And if we're talking the other way, we're just not talking to those folks.
I was going to ask you about something like Medicare for All looking ahead to 2020. So given what you just said, Who's the person? Who's the person, or what kind of person do you really think is viable against President Trump?
Well, you know, who wins the primary is not necessarily the best person in
a
general
election.
So
who should win the primary?
Well, I'm not going to.
I mean, not a specific person, but a kind of person.
Yeah, a kind of person who can go into Michigan and go to the auto plant and have spent time there before and have talked to the workers there and have talked to the families at the churches and have talked to them about how important it is for their kid to get decent health care and that decent health care is with lower premiums and coverage for all. People just want to make sure they have a good job, decent health care, that they can retire with dignity, and that they know that the future is better for their children and grandchildren. When we talk about those things, we have success in the Midwest. I won four elections in a row, elections I never was supposed to have won, because I talked to the hopes and aspirations of good jobs, making sure your kids have a great opportunity, and knowing that you'll get decent health care. That's what this is about.